I gave people all the stuff they really needed. Social security checks, utility bills, TV guide.
I want a TV guidance counselor. TV guidance counselor. Stand up to watch all night, and everything's gonna be alright for my TV guidance counselor.
Hey everybody, welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV guidance counselor, still with my scratchy, allergy-riddled throat. Don't have COVID. Somehow still don't have it. I hope you don't have it either. But anyway, we're not here to discuss that. We're here to discuss classic television using back issues of TV Guide magazine from my personal collection as the gateway into our collective past. And this week, my guest on the show, my guest on the show is Michael Kane. Not that Michael Kane. This is Mike Kane with a K, who is from Massachusetts, from Worcester, Mass. He has a great band called Michael Kane and the Morning Afters. They have a new-ish album out in the last couple of months called Broke But Not Broken. That is very, very good. I think you should get it. You will not be disappointed. Pick it up. Just follow them on all the streaming services and all that. Listen to his music like 700,000 times and he'll get a check for like $6, like I do for the streaming. We're not here to talk about the unfair practices of streaming services. We're here to talk about classic television with interesting people. And that's what we do this week. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest of Michael Kane and the Morning Afters, Mike Kane.
TV is my friend and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Live via satellite from, I believe, Central Massachusetts. Mike Kane, how are you, sir?
Good, thank you. I'm great. How are you?
Good. Yeah, you're in the Worcester area.
Yeah,
right?
Yep.
You grew up there.
I grew up here. This was my, I moved away when I did the married thing for a little bit, like one does. And mm-hmm. I realized it wasn't for me. You got to stay in the 508. So,
yeah, Worcester is, there's a lot of people don't know this, but there's a blue law in Worcester, Mass that you're not allowed to leave Worcester unless via marriage.
That's a dowry thing. That's true. That's true. Yeah.
Worcester's kind of a strange place. Did you watch Kevin Can Go Fuck Himself?
You know, I watched the first couple episodes. I really got to like, I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know that it was like Massachusetts Central or a Worcester. I knew nothing about it. And I put it on and I was like, Jesus Christ. Like I just had to shut it off. Cause like it was too real for a little bit.
Yeah. That's why I couldn't finish it. I watched first two episodes and I'm like, this is way too accurate and it's just making me sad.
Yeah. I'll go back to it, but I just needed a break. Yeah.
Did you watch Wayne?
No.
Oh, Wayne's fucking great. It's a guy who was in hardcore bands and it takes place in Brockton.
Of course
and
it does.
It's like, yeah. It's like if Gross Point Blank was mixed with Repo Man via John Hughes.
I mean, I love Gross Point Blank. Who doesn't? You know, yeah. So, yeah.
It's great. And I had just finished watching Wayne when I started watching Kevin Go Fuck Himself. So I was like, oh, this will be cool. And I'm like, no, no, this is a different thing.
Yeah, yeah.
But Worcester's probably, you know, famous for that most recently. But people may know it as the home of the Moll. That for some weird reason had Judith Light as the spokesperson for years.
Did it really?
Yes. Wow. Yeah. The outlet mall there with the weird candy store.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually worked in that mall for a little bit.
What store did you work at?
There was an arcade there.
Oh, yeah. Was it Dream Machine?
No. Oh no. You know what? This was the lesser of the malls. I worked at MediaPlay.
Oh,
I worked at MediaPlay, which was the Best Buy before the Best Buys. I remember when the, the Elton John Princess Di single came out?
Candle in the Wind 97.
Yeah, we were hawking those singles. But I worked down the street on Front Street. There was a video arcade. It was my first job out of high school. And I feel like I still have PTSD from that job. But yeah,
it was like were you like kids coming up to you with tickets and you giving them like Tootsie Rolls and like switchblade combs?
Dude, I saw a dude get hit in the face, in the front of the face with a baseball bat on like my second week there. And I was
in the arcade?
Oh yeah. Yeah, it was like a gang fight. And like I'm like a suburb kid. Like, I'm just sitting there like, this only happens in movies. Like, this can't be real.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ugh. Brutal.
Yeah.
Brutal.
Man, that's no fun. Judith Light couldn't save you then.
No, not at all. Not at all.
So you're currently at Worcester, and then when you came on camera, I noticed, like, it looks like you live, and this is total pot calling the kettle black here coming from me, but it looks like you're in your ear records.
Yeah. Yeah, fair enough. Yeah.
I have wall of cassettes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If I were to turn the camera, you would see the wall of records. And I just have this, and I'll admit it, that when I see something in the wild, as we call it, you know, even if I have it already, I feel like I just can't leave this. Like,
I'm the same way.
Like, I have 7 copies of the first Elvis Costello record, but like, I'm just not going to leave it there. Like, who knows what could happen to it? So I buy it.
There's like a thrill.
Yeah.
There's like a thrill where you feel that little tinge of when you first bought it.
A little bit. Yeah.
Cause like the first comic I ever bought off the shelf was New Defenders number 142. Mm-hmm. If you're a comic nerd, it's the one with, it's like a parody of the first issue of the Fantastic Four is on the cover. Mm-hmm. And I bought it at Delaney's Superette in Melrose, Mass in 1982. And it's not an expensive book. It's like, it's a quarter bin book. You know, mm-hmm. if you took a walk to That's Entertainment 3 right now, you could pick this up for $1 or less. But anytime I see it in like a quarter bin, I grab it just because I'm like, this is the first one I got. And it's like, you get a little like, ooh.
Yeah, no,
which is ridiculous.
I get the same way with VHS tapes. You know, there's a few movies that if I see in the wild, I will buy.
What are they?
One of them is I Want to Hold Your Hand.
Oh, starring Eddie Deezen.
Yeah, I think it was Zemeckis, right? Zemeckis do that? I think he might have.
First movie, yep.
Yeah.
Robert Zemeckis' first movie, yeah. It was when Beatlemania, the show, was huge.
Yes. Yeah, I was so obsessed with that. I mean, I was obsessed with the Beatles anyways, but like when that came out, I was so obsessed with it. Every once in a while, I'll still find a VHS copy. I think I have like 4 copies on VHS just because it's just like, it's one of those things. I just buy it. I don't know. It's terrible. I'm single too. I don't know if anybody.
I think we picked up on that when you said, I got out of here from the marriage thing and then I moved back.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, it's a little on the nose. You got that. Yeah.
I would be remiss too, before we get into the guide here, if I didn't discuss Worcester, two things, polar seltzer, which I'm drinking now, obviously. And, TableTalk Pies.
TableTalk.
And, yes. As a Worcesterite, do you know what the matriarch who died last year, the matriarch of TableTalk Pies, do you remember what her name was?
I feel like I should, but I don't.
Her real name, Mary Tonnacocaine.
No, it can't be.
Oh, yeah.
I mean.
And it's spelled Tonna-Cocaine.
I mean, if you were to make a name up, you wouldn't name that because it's too on the nose. Like if you were writing like
it's
a comedy.
Too, well, that statement's too on the nose.
Yeah. Wow. Hey.
It's an unbelievable name.
And I'm sure she had a cocaine problem at some point. She had to have because she just had to have.
I mean, she was the Table Talk Pies, what's the word? Heiress. Oh. So, you know, there was probably.
In the 80s.
Crazy parties.
Yeah. Table Talk parties. Absolutely. Those Worcester Table Talk parties.
There's probably some townie who's like, dude, in the fucking 80s I was up at the TableTalk mansion. Those fucking eclair pies, they got turtle pies. I don't even make the turtle pies, but they used to make them just for the fucking parties because the hostess could fuck off.
Yeah, that's too real.
It's just some made up thing.
Yeah, it's too real.
Yeah, Mary Tonnacocaine comes out in a fucking kimono.
Of course.
Yeah, those are my favorite things of Worcester. Of course. If your name is Mary Tonnacocaine, all you wear is kimonos.
You have to. Yeah.
And throw firecrackers. So you picked an issue here. So this is from March 12th to the 18th, 1988.
Yeah.
What spoke to you about this particular
issue? So this, for me, is just the golden age of television for me. This is like before I was like 11 years old. So all the weird cop detective shows didn't get me, because if you flip through any TV guide from the 80s and 90s, there's so many of them. Like, I couldn't tell you what any of them are about. Any of the Cagneys and Lacys and the Jakes and the Fat Man and all that shit. Like, I have no idea because I was just a little too young. But there's so many of them. But the wheelhouse, all those 8 to 9 o'clock shows, all those family shows, those were for me. Those were my wheelhouse. Absolutely.
The sitcoms. Your sitcom.
Absolutely.
Are you an only child?
I have a younger brother. Which we were discussing this a little.
So you were making the decisions.
Yeah. And we were discussing this a little earlier, and it's funny, he's only a few years younger than me, but his TV knowledge is just slightly different. And it's weird how, like, he wouldn't remember one thing and that, you know what I mean? Like, he was, it's so strange how that happens. Like, just a couple years can be like, oh, I never saw Facts of Life, because it was just at the beginning of his TV watching, I guess.
Oh, yeah. And there was that weird mid-range thing when some things were on syndication and then sometimes they weren't. So, like, when we were growing up, Facts of Life, while it was still on new episodes till 87, 88, like, it was on four times a day also in syndication. Mm-hmm. But by, like, 1990, it wasn't even on syndication anymore.
Yeah. It's weird.
And then, like, it jumped back in like, 2000.
Yeah. Like, my default usually was, if there wasn't anything I wanted, I just went to Nick at Night. Like, I went right to the Dennis the Menaces and the Donna Reeds and the Mr. Eds. Like, if there was nothing current, I had my Nickelodeon. I had the Lassie. I mean, Dennis the Menace was my show. Like, it still is. It's on YouTube now. You can watch, like, every episode. I'm still stoked on that.
Do you go back and watch it?
I do. I mean, I have to put this out there. I'm very anti the second Mr. Wilson. It doesn't work. And I heard the first Mr. Wilson died while filming the
show.
Yeah,
he did. Well, not on a take. He was working though, and he died.
Yeah.
So it was like either, and they replaced him. The new Mr. Wilson, I think he was supposed to be his brother or his cousin. I forget which one it was.
Yeah, I think it was his brother.
But yeah, I mean, it was either like you stop doing the show or you have a new Mr. Wilson. Those are the options, you know?
Yeah, but I figured they would just do the whole replace him and not name him. Not rename him.
Oh, like have him be like the actual Mr. Wilson, just like the Darren thing.
Yeah, the Darren thing. Like, nobody's
we're not
going to
acknowledge this as a new actor.
Yeah, nobody's going to care. But they didn't. They did the right thing, I guess.
Were you a fan of the Dennis the Menace cartoon?
I dabbled. I dabbled. It wasn't the same, but I dabbled.
Yeah.
I mean, I loved all the guests. I'm a big fan of guest appearances. So you don't get it with the cartoon. Like Sandy Koufax and Don Drysdale are not going to.
No.
You know, but yeah, I dabbled, but I was more a fan of the live action for sure.
You got a little bit of guest stars on like Flintstones where you have like Anne Margrock and it was really Anne Margaret.
Of course. Of course.
But other than that, you know, yeah, you're right. There wasn't that many on the cartoons. Yeah, Nick at Night was everything. Like it in hindsight, two things that freak me out is one, so 1988, you know, I'm 8 years old, you're 11. We're watching shows on Nick at Night that are at least 25 mm-hmm. to 30 years older than us at that time. And us discussing this now is longer. This guide is longer ago than those shows were when we were watching.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean,
which is freaky.
Yeah. If you want to be bummed out, man, just do the math on how old any of these actors were when these shows came out. It's like, oh, Judith Light was like 36 when it's like, you just feel so old. It's so old.
Yeah. I mean, Ted Danson. So on the cover here, the one critic's verdict is TV getting better or worse by William A. Henry III, who I think was one of our presidents. that's the most I was a president name I've ever seen. William A. Henry III.
Yeah.
But It so it has Lucy, Mash, Alf, and then there's Kirstie Alley and Ted Danson. So this is 88. So Cheers had been on, I think, for 6 seasons. So Ted Danson was, I think, 39.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Which is crazy to me. Like he's younger than me.
Yeah.
Which is insanity. Then we get all the cool, literally cool cigarette ads. We have Cool and Mild, king size soft pack of Cool Mild. Are you a smoker?
I'm not a smoker. My dad was a smoker and it blows me away flipping through that, how prominent it was, how prominent the ads were. It's kind of hilarious.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, now if they're smoking in a movie, they have to have a warning for children.
Yeah, it's like, you ever see any of those commercials where it's like, are you stressed out? Have a Lucky Strike. you're relaxed. It's
just yes. Like, there's a great one in here for Cambridge. It says, taste and compare, generic price, Cambridge. Full flavor lights, ultra low and menthol.
Yeah. Ugh.
Generic price, Cambridge.
That's it.
That's my brand.
That's, there you go.
This article's actually really good. Did you read this article in here about is TV getting better or worse?
I didn't.
It's pretty fascinating because it's well thought out. Like, he talks about a lot of the shows we're watching on Nick at Night, including Car 54, Where Are You? And those sorts of shows. Mm-hmm. But he makes a really interesting point, and it's pulled out as a quote here where it says, nowadays TV gives kids from divorced families less reasons to think of themselves as oddities. And that's true.
I guess.
We started getting representation of, like, you know, families that were less nuclear family, like, you know, they were kind of fucked up.
Yeah.
Like Roseanne's a good example.
Yep. Yep.
Or there was all those divorce that come. So that's probably a good thing. I mean, people are getting some sort of representation. Mm-hmm. And then we have an article on In the Heat of the Night here, the TV series based on the movie, which Anne-Marie Johnson was on, who was just on the show a couple weeks ago. We're at Easter time, so there's a Hallmark ad for Snoopy branded Easter egg decorating kits.
Of course. Yeah.
Which is great.
Yep.
Were you guys a decorating Easter eggs family?
We did the whole thing. We did the whole thing.
Pause.
Oh, yeah. Did the whole thing.
The vinegar.
Yeah. Oh, the whole thing. Oh, yeah. Dipped it in. Yeah. Oh.
There's an article in here about Alan Thicke and his celebrity hockey team, which includes Michael Keaton, Michael J. Fox, and Richard Dean Anderson, MacGyver himself.
That's a lineup right there. If you have a line, that's who you want in your line.
Yeah, I feel like Michael J. Fox would have been the squirrely one that people underestimate.
Yeah, but Richard Dean's the enforcer. Big time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Although I feel like Michael Keaton was garbage, but they liked having him on the team.
Yeah, who wouldn't? It's like a lot of his movies.
He's the comedic. I saw a great movie that he was in called The Protégé recently.
Really?
And it's an action movie with Maggie Q, and he's kind of the villain in it, and he's amazing.
Wow. I mean, he has me because of, you know, Gung Ho and Mr. Mom. So like, I'm good with Michael Keaton. Like, I really shouldn't talk shit.
Yeah. No, he's great. I can't think of a movie I've seen that he was in that I didn't enjoy. Have you ever seen his stand up? Cause he started.
Yeah,
I have.
I have. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not the best,
no.
But you know, he's still charming.
Yeah.
And he started as a production assistant. Do you know this bit of trivia? No. There's a prominent children's TV show that he started on as a production assistant. And George Romero also worked on show. There's a hint for you.
Yeah, no.
Any guesses?
No, not at all.
Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood.
Oh Lord, that's a crew.
Because it's Pittsburgh. It's Pittsburgh. So Romero made some of the shorts, and you know, that's where Michael Keaton's from. So it's great.
Wow.
Also an ad in here for Skor Bar, which is probably the greatest American candy bar of all time.
Skor, yes. I remember that.
Some people are like, oh, it's a Heath. I'm having a Heath bar. And you're like, you're a peasant. The Skor Bar is a Heath bar for people of class and means.
Yes. Yes. Fancy.
I don't think I've eaten a candy bar in about 10 years.
It's been a long time. It's too rich. I can't do it. I'm more of just like a gummy guy. I'm more of,
oh, really?
I'm more of like, you know, Sour Patch Children and gummy bears and gummy worms and all the gummies.
I like some of the gummies. I was a big Sour Patch Kids were my go-to movie theater snack for years. But I've tried to buy them now and I'm just like, I can't do them. They're just like too much.
Yeah. Your tongue starts to bleed. It's brutal.
Yeah. I got a kid too. I told this on one of my albums, but I got a kid to snort Sour Patch Kid dust once, which is just citric acid.
Oof.
Cause, in high school, kids always thought cause I used to go hang out in the city. They thought I was like knew about drugs and I totally don't. And, this kid was like, hey man, you like something about drugs. And I was like, and I had been eating Sour Patch Kids because I, with my first job when I was 13, I got a membership to BJ's Wholesale Club.
Oh, wow. There you go. That's very progressive of you.
Yeah. And I would buy like the candy store size boxes of sour cherry, you know, the Sour Patch Cherries. Mm-hmm. So I'd put them in little baggies and bring them to school. And all that was left was the citric acid. And this kid snorted it. And he was, ooh, boy, that must have hurt.
Yeah, absolutely. Oof.
And then I got him to do it again. So this is Saturday. This is a Providence edition. So you're probably getting some of the Rhode Island and Connecticut stations as well as the Boston station.
Yeah.
And Worcester, I imagine. Which I was always jealous of. Like, you had like two NBCs if you really wanted them.
Yeah. I don't remember having the two. I just remember having the TV with a few channels, but I do remember a majority of these shows.
So let's dive in. What'd you do on Saturday night here?
See, Saturday night was a March weird 12th. One because I know I saw my fair share of David Copperfield, but I don't even know why why would I have watched that? Like, that's terrible.
It was a big deal, but it was a huge deal. I mean, he would do these magic specials. I think he did like two a year.
Yeah.
This is The Magic of David Copperfield 10, the Bermuda Triangle.
Oh, I remember.
This one was really dramatic.
Yes.
This one was craziness. It says, all new special. Can David Copperfield challenge the mysterious and deadly forces of the Bermuda Triangle and return alive? With a question mark. Will he escape from the incredible death saw? All new illusions, comedy, romance, and Webster the Duck. Which is...
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I watched it.
And I know that... Oh, I totally did. They were super entertaining. And I 100% know that David Copperfield did not exclusively soundtrack his shows with Peter Gabriel music, but I'm kind of also pretty sure that he exclusively soundtracked his shows with Peter Gabriel music.
Yeah. No, I believe that. Yeah. I don't, like I said,
all I can picture is that.
Yeah. I know I watched it, but again, I don't know. Maybe just being a kid, but a magic show on TV just as an adult does not have the appeal as it did, I think, when I was a child. But, oh yeah, I was all about it. I was all about it.
I mean, magic shows on TV kind of, I mean, although I do love Penn and Teller Fool Us. Have you ever seen that?
Yes, that's great. Absolutely.
That is fantastic because it has an extra element.
Yeah.
But this was the kind of thing, like, if you didn't watch this special, like, when you went to school on Monday after the weekend, like, kids would be like, what the hell's wrong with you? Why didn't you watch Magic of David Copperfield?
I know. You had to.
Even though it is super cheesy. And David Blaine totally blew David Copperfield stuff away when he was doing that street magic. And all of a sudden, the, like, weird, like, sexy open shirt, I look like Bob Saget, but I think I'm sexy David Copperfield thing.
Yeah.
Kind of fell apart.
Yeah.
There's a really good Facts of Life episode on this night, too. I 100% was watching that David Copperfield special, but I would have been torn because I was, like, a diehard Facts of Life person, and this was the final season. And this is a really weird episode.
Yeah, I just got the end of Facts of Life.
The end of the episode or the end of the run?
Just the end of the run. I didn't get into it because I didn't get into it when I was super young, but I caught it the last probably couple seasons, I think. And this was probably the end. I remember watching.
Right, so that was like Clooney.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is a heavy episode. So Paul Provenza is in this episode. He runs a youth center that Joe works at. And this one's heavy. It's Joe's job at the social services center gets a bit hairy when her supervisor, a suicide prevention counselor, threatens to leap off a building.
Wait, it gets a little hairy? Is that what they said? It got a little wacky.
That's what they say. Because what's funnier?
Gets a little
than
wacky.
Suicide. See, it's funny because he's a suicide counselor.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Gets but, a little
I mean,
zany.
One of the classic sitcom. A little wacky. One of the classic sitcom episodes was like talking someone off a ledge, literally, right?
Yeah.
That was in every show had an episode like that.
Yeah, this was a very special Facts of Life.
To the point where I thought it'd be funny if someone did a talk show where you interview the guests through a window and they're out on a ledge.
Yeah.
Like, because they have those sets built. You got to use it. It'll be like the ledge in Cat's Eye.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so a very special Facts of Life.
Fine, Stephen King film.
One of many, I'm sure.
I mean, yeah, pretty much every episode of Facts of Life is very special. I don't think it's on. Do you do Punky Brewster the next night? Mm-hmm. No, I think it had ended, but you and I were talking about very special episodes, and we were talking about The Gift before.
Oh, The Gifts. Ugh, such a hard watch.
Which features the meanest thing ever said on television.
Alan, he's a bitch.
What a dick that kid was, and I feel so bad for that actor because he's probably a nice kid, but he, like, no one would cast him in things.
I don't,
because he seemed like such an asshole.
I wouldn't either. Oh, Jesus.
But he was in two shows at once. He was also on Belvedere playing Wesley's friend Miles with the headgear.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So hardworking kid.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
There's a weird show here that was on Fox in the first season, the first season of Fox. Mm-hmm. And it is probably the most generically named show ever. It's just called Women in Prison.
Oh, so it's like a prequel to like Orange is the New Black.
Basically, it's a 30-minute multicam sitcom comedy about women in prison.
Oh, Lord.
And it didn't go more than a season, as you can imagine. Dolly's also on that night, which was an amazing variety show that Dolly Parton did that still holds up. I don't even like most of the musical guests, like Randy Travis is in this one. But Nell Carter and Dolly do a song like, you know, I bet this is amazing.
Yeah. See, I wasn't watching it then, but I would totally watch it now. I'd be all over it now.
A lot of it is on YouTube and it's well worth watching.
Yes.
I highly recommend it. Spencer for Hire is on at 10 o'clock that night as well, which, you know, is my favorite.
Yeah. I never got into, that's a cop show, right?
Were you watching that as a kid?
No, I didn't get into any cop detective drama shows. Like, I don't know. I was all comedy all the time.
Oh, so no action, no Hunter, no Spencer.
I mean, I did Knight Rider. I think that was probably I did Knight Rider and then maybe like a sprinkle of like Magnum PI. That's kind of where I left it.
Fair enough. I mean, Magnum PI was basically a comedy.
But yeah, for sure.
Also, just it's outside the purview. It's at 10 o'clock, mm-hmm. but Uptown Comedy Express is on, which was a show that I wish I watched at the time, mm-hmm. which was the Uptown Comedy Arts Theater in downtown LA, which was like the African-American comedy club.
Okay.
Robert Townsend's hosting this episode. 1988, though, the guests are Chris Rock, Arsenio Hall, Marshall Warfield, and Barry Sobel.
Barry Sobel's in that, huh? How did he get in that? That group.
Pretty good lineup.
Yeah.
And then I was not a huge wrestling person, but in 88, I was super into wrestling.
Me too. I saw at 10 o'clock, it just says wrestling. So I don't know what wrestling means at 10 o'clock, but
SNL would take a hiatus once a month. So SNL would be on 3 weekends a month. Mm-hmm. One of those weekends would be Saturday Night Main Event. And this one I specifically remember watching. This is Hulk Hogan versus King Harley Race, mm-hmm. Macho Man versus the Million Dollar Man, and Brutus the Barber versus Greg Valentine.
Oh, see, because he's a barber and a beefcake. That's right. Yeah. I went to one of those at the Centrum.
One of the tapings of Saturday Night's Main Event?
I did.
Do you remember who was wrestling?
I looked it up recently because they have all the lineups on Wikipedia, and it was like the Junkyard Dog era, King Kong Bundy, Andre the Giant. It was like the big peak where they had the cartoon and the whole thing.
Rock and wrestling.
Yeah, I was pretty stoked.
Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
He's a barber and a beefcake. What can you say?
Brutus the Barber from Central Mass.
Is he really? I just assume they're all from Florida.
It's true. Like, beefcake's not a word that we hear often anymore. You never heard the cocaine story about him?
The cocaine story? Is there one? I figured there'd be a few.
Well, there's probably several. But after 9/11,
yeah.
You know it's a good story when I'm talking about Brutus the Barber Beefcake, and the story starts with after 9/11.
Yes.
They had to evacuate Downtown Crossing because someone found a white powder they thought was anthrax. But it wasn't anthrax. It was cocaine. And it was cocaine that belonged to the guy who sold tokens in the booth. And the guy who sold tokens in the booth was Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
Oh, no shit. Does he doesn't have like a shitty like Boston accent either. I wish he did. I wish he had a shitty Boston accent, but he doesn't.
No.
Maybe he hides it.
I mean, it's hard to tell though, because like most of the time he's talking and he's just like, yeah, brother. Like it's hard. Yeah, you know, just, everyone just sounds constipated.
Yeah, he's just yelling.
I was at my barber once.
Yeah.
And he was cutting my hair because he's my barber. And I'm looking and there's an autographed 8x10 black and white of Brutus the Barber Beefcake on the wall. And I go, oh, wow, Brutus Barber Beefcake, does he come in there to get his haircut? And he goes, yeah, he's here right now. And he pointed and he was just like waiting to get his haircut.
Oh, wow. Look at you.
He was like, oh, what's up, man?
Look at you.
It was really weird.
Rubbing shoulders.
Very, very strange. Where are we? Sunday night, what'd you do?
Sunday night, I did. Sunday night was an easy one for me. Sunday night was Family Ties and Day by Day, back to back. Religiously, no problem. That's Sunday night, right? Family Ties and Day by Day. Yeah, no problem with those.
Oh yeah, yep.
Like Day by Day, like I still can quote and remember a lot of the Day by Day Brady Bunch episode. I love the crossovers. where the kid thought he
was the classic.
Where the kid thought he wanted to have the Brady's parents, and then he ended up being in the movie. He was Greg. How crazy is that? Like,
yeah, he played Greg in the movie.
He played Greg, yeah. Christopher Barnes.
He's excellent.
Yeah, he's really good. And Family Ties prior to that, which is, I mean, it's a classic. I don't know if it holds up. I put on a couple episodes and it's like kind of a tough watch, but I was watching it.
It can get pretty heavy.
Yeah.
This episode made me really sad because Andy goes to school with a kid who is hearing impaired and learns sign language, and like, yep, Skippy knows sign language. And then it's like, you just feel bad for everybody. Do you remember what punk rock band Brian Bonzel, who plays Andy on Family Ties, was in?
Yeah. Wasn't he in the Ataris or something, like one of those bands?
Yes.
Yeah.
He played guitar in the Ataris.
Yeah. Isn't it funny how, like, after it ended, they had like all sorts of exposés on him, and he was just like a teenage kid smoking weed.
Oh yeah.
And it was in the news.
He was like slightly less dirtbag than your average kid.
Yeah.
But a little bit more than your average TV kid.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
So it was like it had a lip ring. They were like, oh no.
Yeah, watch out.
Oh no.
Watch out.
The People's Choice Awards are that night. And my favorite thing about this particular issue of TV Guide that I scanned is that the person who owned this previously filled out the People's Choice Awards thing with their picks for who should win.
Oh shit. That's intense.
So it's page 67. Their favorite female performer, Dolly Parton, but Cybill Shepherd won. So they like checked off who they wanted, but then they circled who actually won.
Oh,
which is great because they gave up halfway through. So like the second one was Bill Cosby, less said the better, but they nailed that one. They got Cosby Show as favorite show, favorite drama, LA Law, favorite television talk show host, Oprah Winfrey. And then she stopped picking like who won. So, like, I don't know who else won these. Did you two win favorite rock group?
Oh, I bet they did.
I don't know, man. Did you see who they're up against?
I don't know, but 88, you're thinking, like, that's Joshua Tree, right? Like,
yeah, but also Massachusetts U2 was unusually popular compared to the rest of the world because they were from Ireland.
Yeah, good point. Because
people from Massachusetts will like any band from Ireland.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I've said this before, but I've heard guys from Charlestown be like, dude, the fucking Cores are actually pretty fucking awesome.
Yeah, I never got into U2, so I can't.
Me either. They're one of those bands that if they're on the radio, I'm like, oh yeah, but I'd never like actively put them on.
Yeah, I remember talking to Mark Lind about this, and I'm like, dude, I don't get U2. I can't. He goes, oh, you're just too far west. He said something. You just, you know, like it's a city. It's an inner city. U2's an inner city band. they're a child. He's like, oh yeah, you wouldn't get them out in Worcester.
Which is like, yeah, but like U2 was the stuff of like 19-year-old college girls.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Oh, too far out west. Well, the other two bands are against is Bon Jovi and Whitesnake. So, I mean, Whitesnake would have kicked their ass, I would have thought.
Yeah.
This is Here I Go Again.
Yeah, I take Whitesnake over the two, out of all the three, for sure.
I am not ashamed to admit that there's like maybe three or four Whitesnake songs that I just think are awesome.
Yeah, they're great. Yeah, they shred.
Like Heat of the Night.
Yeah.
Amazing song.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. I love David Coverdale's speaking voice. He sounds like Roger Moore.
Yeah, very fancy.
Which is just great. I hate Led Zeppelin, although I like Whitesnake. It doesn't make sense. Eh. I love Soundgarden. Don't like Led Zeppelin.
It's okay.
When people pointed out to me that people sound like Robert Plant, it like ruins my day, and then I get over it.
Yeah.
The Terminator is on that night at 9, which is a movie I will watch anytime it's on.
I did actually, because of my just overall obsession with music as a kid, I did Eddie and the Cruisers, which I think was on that night.
Yep.
I did Eddie and the Cruisers, which, like, looking back on it, like, wasn't Eddie and the Cruisers really just like, I know all these like networks were trying to get Bruce Springsteen to act at the time. Like, they really thought he had like the it thing. So he probably would have been Eddie in the Cruiser. Or you would have been.
Oh, yeah. Know,
but they couldn't get him. So then this gets made. And then a sequel.
What, the sequel is weird. Have you seen the
sequel? I have. I've only seen it like once, but I'm sure it's bizarre.
I love Michael Paré. And he's so like, he's in Streets of Fire, which is one of my favorite movies. Mm-hmm. I think he had a drug problem, because he kind of, like, he's a guy who easily could have been a massive movie star. Like, he is a great actor, is a handsome guy. He had, like, the thing, you know, he had, like, that charm, mm-hmm. but kind of just disappeared. And I think there was a drug issue. Mm. And Eddie and the Cruisers 2 and Bad Moon were, like, the last two movies I remember him seeing him in. Bad Moon, where he plays a werewolf.
Oh, wow.
Which is fantastic.
That's nice.
Have you ever seen Bad Moon?
No.
It's actually pretty good. It was written and directed by Eric Red, who wrote The Hitcher, which is one of my favorite movies, mm-hmm. and Near Dark, and Cohen and Tate. And it was based on this book called Thor. And the book is from this dog named Thor's perspective, which sounds stupid, but go with me on this. So it's written in the dog's head. But basically, this single mother and her kid, the single mother's, like, a strange brother, like, comes to live with them out of nowhere,
yeah.
and he's a werewolf, and the dog knows, because mm-hmm. he's a dog, he can tell, right?
Of course.
So the whole book is, like, this dog trying to alert the family that the brother's a werewolf and also protect them, but he's a dog, so, like, he can't tell them. So the movie, obviously, you know, the dog's not talking and stuff, but it's a pretty good adaptation of the book.
Wow, that's intense.
I recommend it. Pale Rider is also on, and I'm not a huge Clint Eastwood guy, but I love that one because he's a ghost.
Yeah, I think the only other thing I did that night was Gary Shandling.
I loved It's Gary Shandling. Yeah, show.
Me too. So I Googled that episode to try to get reminded of what episode it was, and so hilarious. Like, 8 months later, after baby Jessica falls in the well, they do an episode on how Gary falls in a hole in his backyard, like, awesome, right? Awesome. He's just yes. in a hole. So, like, I do remember yes. watching that originally, but looking back on it, I find it just hilarious that they, like, spoofed it.
Well, I mean, The Simpsons did the Bart in the Well one in, like, 91 or 92. Like, baby Jessica, she was still in the zeitgeist, you know, 5-6 years after that happened.
Yeah, she had a run. She had a run.
I'll never forget. I'll never forgive her, because her falling down that well interrupted Rags to Riches, and I never saw how that episode ended until it came out on DVD in the 2000s. I'll never forgive her. She managed to keep out of the public eye. Can you imagine if you're, like, you meet this girl in college and you're dating, and then, like, do you think she ever confesses to you that she was baby Jessica?
Absolutely. It's first date shit.
You think so?
Oh, yeah. It's the same as, really? Like, the B girl from the Blind Melon video. It's first date shit. I'll tell you that.
She's like, you know, I am baby Jessica.
I fell in the well. I was in the well. Yeah.
Would you be like, I can't date you? Or would you be like, oh, even better?
Knowing me, like, 40 years after it happens, I'd be like, we got to capitalize on this shit. Like, I try to spin it into something. Let's start a podcast about you being in the well.
Like, I'd be like, let's do a wellness podcast.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, and she'd be like,
it's a pun. People will fall for it. It's great.
Yeah.
So did you have cable at this time?
I did. I think I did, yeah. Like, I remember doing, like, a lot of, like, Fraggle Rock, and I think that was on HBO.
Yep.
So, yeah, I did Fraggle Rock. I know I had the USA channel. So, yeah, I definitely had cable.
Up All Night.
Yeah.
Cartoon Express, yep. and that kind of stuff. Yep. The Hitcher and, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, The Hitchhiker, and were you watching a lot of MTV because you're a big music guy? Is that where you're getting most of the stuff?
A lot of MTV, you know, early 90s MTV was all, like, you know, back when there was music on MTV, it was, I was into all that shit. I was into all the, like, hey, we're going to find a DJ somewhere, and, like, all the contests, and, like, I was into it. Yeah, I was into it.
I always like to point this episode out to people because there's a lot of episodes of the show. People miss episodes sometimes. But I had the guy on who won the Lost Weekend with Van Halen contest on MTV. Ooh, in 1984.
I remember that. Yeah. Wow.
Awesome dude. He's just some dude who works in a warehouse in Philadelphia. He was 17. He won the thing. You know, the Van Halen video for Panama? Yeah. That's the weekend that he was with Van Halen when that video was shot.
Oh, wow.
So, as you can imagine, it was insane.
Wow.
That was the contest. They just sent some 17-year-old kid unsupervised to party with Van Halen for 3 days.
I mean, that's what the contest was. You got to do it.
They had some weird contests. Remember they had the Little Pink Houses contest?
Yep.
With John Mellencamp? So someone won a whole town full of pink houses in the middle of nowhere.
I mean, honestly, I wish they just filmed those pitch meetings. Like, I wish we could watch those. Be like, what do we do? Like, I mean, though, that's gold right there. Those pitch meetings must have been hilarious.
I entered every single contest, even though I was way too young. I think you had to be at least 15 to enter them.
Probably.
But they had one at 85 that was go on a big adventure with Pee Wee Herman to celebrate Pee Wee's Big Adventure. And I think you went to three cities and saw the premiere in three cities. So it was like LA, New York, and London.
Wow.
And they put you on like that Concorde. It was crazy. Like, that is nuts.
Yeah.
Have you ever won a contest?
I've never won a contest. Although I remember being jealous of the one that Jessie Camp won, the VJ one. I remember. Although I was way too young at the time. But fast forward about 30 years later, 20 years later, me and my friend are going to see Alice Cooper in Northampton. And who is standing in the lobby? Right? But Jessie Camp. He has a red leather jacket on, and I'm not going to say that he looked old or he looked terrible, like whatever, but like, I spotted him. It was like 30 years later. I was like, that's the guy. That's Jessie Camp, MTV. I love that record too. And I went up to him. And I was like, I love the record. Cause like Dogs D'Amour were on it. And like Hanoi Rocks were on it. It's actually like, if you take away his vocals just out of it entirely, it's a good rock and roll record. And I told him that, well, not the vocal part, but like the fact that
I love that record. If you get rid of your vocals, I mean, his vocals just sounded exactly like Tim Armstrong.
Well, like a little bit of Steven. There was a little bit of Steven Tyler. There was a little bit of a little bit of everybody.
Yeah. I mean, that guy, he always looked bad. Which means as he got older, he de facto looks good.
Yeah, he just looked like, I don't know. He just looked like a bag of trash. It was just, I don't know.
Yeah, but he always did. So you're like, wow, you look the same.
Yeah.
You know, it's like Steven Tyler.
Yeah, pretty much.
So Monday, what'd you do?
Monday, I was, wedged in the middle of Monday, there was Prince's Trust Rock Concert, which I definitely did. But I definitely did Alf, 100%. I did Valerie's Family. Early on, I did Valerie's Family. I don't know that I necessarily went over to the Hogan Family. Did you make the transition?
Nope. I will never forgive Sandy Duncan for what she did.
Yeah. I was just Valerie's Family, and that was it. That was it.
I love that show.
Yeah.
It's fun.
Yeah, they lost me. They lost
it's,
me.
One of my favorite theme songs. Like if I had a band, I would cover that song.
Yeah. Yeah. There was a lot.
It's a great song.
There was a lot of good
life
songs.
Is such a sweet insanity. What's your favorite TV theme song?
Ooh, I don't know. You know what? Like ever since I realized that so many of them were written by Alan Thicke, I just sort of like didn't enjoy him as much. Like I like Alan Thicke and he's fine and all. But like, don't they all sound the same? Like all those like mid to late 80s, like Growing Pains, like they all have that like.
The ones he wrote certainly do.
Yeah, because he wrote a ton, didn't he? Didn't he write like a good amount of them?
He wrote Different Strokes. He wrote Facts of Life.
Did he write Different Strokes?
That's kind of it for big ones.
Different Strokes. That's probably my favorite. I mean, that rules.
His wife did that song, Friends and Lovers. Do you remember that song?
Yeah, I feel like I know it. Huh, Friends and Lovers.
Maybe we could be both for each other.
That sounds terrible. Well, not how you're singing it, but.
She's the mother of Robin Thicke.
Yeah, she really is.
One of my favorite TV theme songs to sing, and it's just like fun to belt out, is Perfect Strangers.
Oh, Perfect Strangers. We have to get the Perfect Strangers for sure.
Yeah, but that theme song, man, and lyrically, you know, it's got that sadness. Sometimes the world looks perfect, nothing to rearrange. Sometimes you just get a feeling like you need some kind of change.
Oh, man, that show.
A lot of them just sound like Bryan Adams.
It's a good point.
But Valerie's theme song is what I would cover.
All right, well, then you got to get a new band. and do it.
Yeah, just for that.
Just for that.
I gotta say, I'm not a good singer, but even despite that, or because of that, some of those, there's some range in those songs that are a little hard to hit. There's some high notes. There's some of those melodies. A little tough.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, they had to sell the show, man.
Yeah. That same guy must have sang all of them. Like the vaguely Michael Bolton-y guy.
Yeah, because they all sound the
same.
That
sang most theme songs. Oh, yeah. Well, that was the big thing then, though, that like slightly gravelly voiced, like Richard Marx type.
Yeah. I mean, you hit the nail on the head with Bryan Adams, for sure. It was all very Bryan
Adams. And I'm not mad at that. There's nothing wrong with that. You know, this is before we got sick of them with Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
Oh, yeah, that was tough.
You know, one of my least favorite things about the Boston punk scene in the 90s was how many bands covered Summer of 69.
Did they really? See, because...
Oh, my God, it was vile.
I went to enough of those shows where I feel like I should have known that. But, yeah, it seems like on the nose for that. It does.
It was awful. And it was the kind of thing where it wasn't ironic in any way, which made it worse. Like, normally I'm the opposite on that kind of thing. But people would be like, no, man, that kicks ass.
Did they dedicate it to, like, punk? Like, did they dedicate to, like, punks and skins and stuff and made it?
This is for the punks and skins, Summer 69.
I mean, the dude couldn't even keep his band together through, like, the first verse. Like, respect. They break up in, like, the third line of the song. Like,
yeah, clearly they're not good.
No, they have no commitment at all.
Oh, God. Yeah, it was like you'd watch a band cover like four Oi songs and then Summer of 69. Sometimes you'd have more than one band on the same bill cover Summer of 69. They'd be like, fuck you, we're not taking that out of our set list just because they played it first. But it was like, no, please, dude, take it out of your set. Like, it's a cut, like, swap it out. Dude, we're not going to take it or something else.
Yeah. Just do another Cocksparrer cover. You'll be fine.
Yeah. People used to get mad because I always called Cocksparrer Dick Puncher.
Yeah.
Well. Yeah. Very popular band. For people that don't know, Cocksparrer UK, like a 70s bar rock band that somehow became massively huge among like skinheads and punk rockers, even though they sound like dad rock.
Yeah. Yeah, catchy as
and
shit, though.
It's catchy, but God, did I hated them so much at that time. I was like, they were like one step above what somebody would play in Guitar Center if they were just hanging out playing PV guitars. It's like the punk rock equivalent of Smoke on the Water. But no one's ever shared this opinion with me. I seem to be the outlier.
I think you are.
Yeah, but they're just like, I don't know, like the Stranglers or something. They're way better.
Yeah, I mean, for me, Oi is generally so fucking terrible that like...
Oh, of course.
That like, if there's any melody at all, I'm like, this is fucking great. Like, look at the melody in this. Like,
I had a fake Oi band for a while that we were trying to get booked on shows, and we were called The Ejaculated.
Nice.
Yeah, and it was pretty fun. Monday night, there is a movie on that night. It's a made-for-TV movie starring William Shatner and Susan Blakely, and it says, she's the best student in the junior class. And a member of the city's worst gang, a broken angel, a story of a family in crisis.
Oh, Jesus.
Wow. Gangs were a huge scare thing. Like, they would tell you that, like, they would force you to be in a gang. Like, some like, African-American street gang is going to conscript some 15-year-old white suburban girl into their gang.
Yeah. I feel like in the early 80s, there was a lot of gang-themed sitcoms, too. Like, I'm pretty sure A-Team had a handful.
Oh, yeah. Gangs always came up. But they would be that kind of, like, Beat It video, multi, you know, UN, like, United Nations of gangs, though.
Somebody told me there was, like, the ALF set, there was, like, Trenches. Have you heard about this?
Yeah.
Like, is that true?
Oh, yeah, because he's a puppet.
So like,
yeah, because he's a puppet. So they have,
so like the person running ALF essentially just ran the whole show. All the actors had to like step around all these trenches.
Yeah, but that's the case with any puppet show. Like all the Muppet shows, all the sets are built raised up. so that the puppeteers can be underneath them. Yeah. And Paul Fusco, who was Elf, he would stay in character too. So, and he was kind of an asshole.
Did he do the voice?
I have friends who are, yeah, he did the voice. He created the show and he did Elf's voice and he puppeteered Elf.
Oh, wow.
And, he's from Connecticut originally. And I have friends who were on Elf and like, they got in like arguments with him in character as Elf, like between takes.
Oh man.
Cause he was just such a dickhead. He was like kind of a, like a little bit right wing and like kind of an asshole. Oh. Like they're getting like political arguments with this puppet.
Yeah. All I remember after that is the father getting into some shenanigans towards the end of his life.
Yeah. Max Wright had some issues.
It was kind of the first time I remember seeing like somebody I knew on National Enquirer.
Like, oh yeah. Cause they were like, he's smoking crack with prostitutes. Which I think he did, but you know, whatever.
Yeah, whatever. It's
his retirement. Let him do what he wants. It's not hurting anybody.
Not at all.
And the prostitutes. There is, before we get to Tuesday night, there's a coupon in here.
Oh.
And it's on page 109, and it's amazing because it's for corned beef hash, but they've done the word hash in the MASH logo.
Oh wow.
With like the ampersands in between. So it's America's Original Prudence. Beef and roast beef or corned beef hash. 15 cents off. Wow. They're like a TV guide. We'll make it look like MASH.
I mean, I guess it makes sense, right? It's like Easter, you know?
Is hash a big Easter food?
Isn't it corned beef hash? Is that Easter?
Isn't that... No, well, corned beef and cabbage is St. Patrick's Day.
St. Patrick's Day. It's all terrible. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think corned beef hash is an Easter thing. There's also an amazing after school special on that day.
Oh, nice.
Called Daddy Can't Read.
Oh, no.
Allison Watson knew there were people who didn't know how to read. She just didn't know one of them was her father. Starring Edward Albert, co-starring Kathy Rigby McCoy, Richard Roundtree, Shaft himself, and Joey Travolta, John Travolta's brother.
Oh, Joey Travolta. Yeah, it's kind of like that Dustin Hoffman movie. Didn't he have one where he couldn't read?
Rain Man?
Stanley and Iris. Remember that one?
Oh, that's right. Yes, yes, yes.
He couldn't read in that.
Well, there's the famous Webster episode where Papa Papadopoulos can't read.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember that.
He was like, I can't read. George, I just ordered what you order at the restaurant.
Oh, jeez. Why'd they have to make things so sad?
Because they wanted us to be empathetic and be better people. And clearly that worked. There's also an ad in here for a new show. So it's a mid-season replacement. Mm-hmm. And it stars Christopher Lloyd. And it says, we interrupt this magazine with a message from your new leader, Christopher Lloyd in The Dictator.
Oof.
So it's a multi-cam sitcom where Christopher Lloyd plays... like a third world country dictator.
Oh, man. I mean, wasn't he sort of just like balls deep into Back to the Future at that point? Like, you know?
I guess, but this is Christopher Lloyd is president for life, Paul Joseph Domino, a deposed South Sea Island ruler running a coin laundry in Ringo Park, Queens, with his wife Isabel and their children Reggie and Andrew. Robin Lively, Blake Lively's sister, who is in Teen Witch. In the opener, Domino and the ever-loyal General Vesuvio learn of unrest in the islands and plot a coup to return to power. David Alan Grier is in this. So this is a deposed dictator running a laundromat in Queens is the premise of this show.
I mean, I'm in. Like... I'm in. If you find an episode of that, send it my way. I would like to give it a watch.
I am curious because it sounds god awful. Christopher Lloyd, of course, famously told me I was not funny in front of 5,000 people.
He doesn't seem like he has a sense of humor, though. To be fair,
he's bonkers.
Yeah, yeah.
Like he's. I was asking him about the show Fringe, which is one of my favorite shows, and he's on an episode, and he goes, "Fringe." And I go, yeah, it was a show that you were in.
No.
I was like, it wasn't that long ago.
No, he just wasn't said that no. Long ago. Nope.
Yeah. The Wonder Years is on opposite The Dictator, and The Wonder Years is one of my all-time favorite shows.
Yeah. The Wonder Years, same. but revisiting the Wonder Years a little bit, what laws changed to make it so they could play all that music? Like, how did that go down? Because, like, they had, like, just classic rock and roll. Like, who were they paying? Did they not have to pay anybody in the 80s? Like, now they could never get away with that.
For the music?
Yeah. I mean, like...
Well, because it wasn't... it was kind of single-use agreements.
Okay.
So you could... The idea was that it wasn't going to be in perpetuity. Like the concept of reruns and like TV on DVD or streaming, yeah, like that hadn't come into play. So they're like, yeah, of course you can use this song for this one episode that'll air once.
Yeah.
Maybe twice, you know?
Yeah.
They didn't have any agreements for home video, which is why that show was sort of not on DVD or not streaming or not in reruns for so long because of the music rights. And the master tapes had the music like ingrained in it. So it was really hard to put like sound alikes in. But that show, it's the same with WKRP.
Yeah. I think the Wonder Years might be the first show I remember like a series finale for that I was really like, I can't believe the show is ending type of thing. Like when that show ended, I felt like I was crushed.
Did you cry?
Like, how can this end?
Yeah, I cried.
Yeah. Brutal.
It was brutal.
It was brutal.
And it was such a sad ending too.
Yep.
When you find out that dad died, oh my God.
Yeah, man.
Oh my God.
Terrible. And of course there was a Punky Brewster cameo famous in Wonder Years. You know?
Yep.
So
pre-breast reduction.
Of course.
She meets Kevin in the summer. They go swimming in a lake.
Yeah, I remember them on a boat.
In the rain.
Yep. I mean, I'm a big Punky Brewster. Yeah. Did you watch the reboot?
No, but I heard it was actually pretty good. Did you like it?
It was great. It was great. I'm kind of bummed there wasn't a second season. There was a lot of heart. It was great. No Henry, of course, but they had nods.
No Alan.
No. I thought it'd be different without Henry, but I've always wondered, like, because I mean, obviously he was in a ton of shit, like Police Academy, of course. Yeah, and
Police
like,
Academy.
But George what Gaines, is, the where's producers. He from and what is that accent?
It's a mid-Atlantic accent, they call it. So he's American, but he was a guy who went to theater school and that's how they taught you to speak, to enunciate and to speak like an actor, you know? And it was a purposefully designed accent so that you could be in movies that were in England or in America and it would all kind of work. Like it didn't, everyone was kind of cool with it. They were like, there's like a halfway in the middle. We're fine.
Yeah. It's weird, man. It's bonkers accent, but like, I loved him. And like I said, if you have a chance to check the reboot, there's no Alan and there's no Mike the teacher, but you get Cherry.
No Brandon.
You get Cherry and Punky.
Yeah. And Margot. Margot shows up.
She does, I think, for like a second though.
Yeah, she does. Yeah. But she had quit acting. She hadn't acted in like 30 years and she showed up and was on the show, which is pretty awesome.
That is awesome. Yeah.
Also, in the first season of Punky Brewster, speaking of I Want to Hold Your Hand...
Eddie
Deezen.
Yeah, wasn't he a janitor?
Yes, he was.
Before the other janitor. Oh, no, he wasn't a janitor. Wasn't he like the super in the building?
Yes, okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you recall the Night Stalker episode of Punky Brewster?
The Night. I feel like I do. I can't. I can't think of it.
There was an episode inspired by Richard Ramirez, The Night Stalker.
Fair enough.
Totally makes sense. Wednesday, what'd you do?
Wednesday, I was head of the class all the way, but I was very much like a Howard Hessman guy. So mm-hmm. when they made the switch, I didn't really go with it. I don't know if you did.
I loved Billy Connolly. Like he's a great stand up
yeah.
and just like such an amazing, like personality, mm-hmm. but yeah, it didn't work really well on that show. And also when Billy Connolly came in, and this makes sense given that it's a high school and the kids are going to graduate, they had a pretty much 99% new class as well. Like it wasn't any of the kids either, yeah. which makes sense, but yeah, it didn't feel like the same show. So it just didn't. Did you see the reboot of that?
I heard there is one, but I have not.
It is bad.
Yeah. I mean,
it is not good.
I mean, to take a show that really didn't have a premise anyways, really, and you want to reboot it, like, I don't know. I don't know, man.
Yeah. It and I've rewatched that show often because I love that show, and it is streaming on, I think it's on HBO Max, or Disney Plus, one of them. I think it's HBO Max. And I love it. It's still funny. It's great, even though, you know, Dennis Blundin's a monster in real life. You know, it's funny, and there's great episodes, and it's a fun show. One thing you didn't watch Wednesday at 8 o'clock was a new show called Aaron's Way.
Ooh.
And this is when we were in a huge obsession with the Amish. So America went through a big Amish phase where, like, Amish was every show had an Amish episode. MacGyver, Mr. Belvedere, the movie Witness was huge. Like, Amish were everywhere. And then the Amish were replaced by the Australians.
Oh, okay.
But this is a show about an Amish guy who moves in with a woman who's not Amish, and she's played by Jessica Walters, who is the mother from Arrested Development.
Of course, yeah.
I don't remember the show, but it sounds totally crazy. Aaron's Way. It was on 2 hour of Family Hours with Aaron's Way and Highway to Heaven. Growing Pains, obviously, huge Growing Pains fan. This is season 3, which is my favorite season of the show, right when Just the 10 of Us spun off. So I was totally watching that. Yep. And then Head of the Class, obviously, as well. This is the episode where they do Grease.
Oh.
They would do a musical once a year?
Yeah, I actually saw one. I saw the Dennis Blundin heavy episode where he wanted to join the football team but also wanted to be in the play. I'm aware.
Yes, and I think he ends up being, is that the one where he ends up being Audrey too when they do Little Shop of Hearts?
I think so. Yeah,
there's also the show on that night that was okay, but I really loved it, and it was short-lived, but it had Dabney Coleman in it, and I watched Dabney Coleman in anything. It's the Slap Maxwell Story.
Oh, I never saw that. What?
No one did.
What was his big show?
Well, he was in a show called Buffalo Bill that was on 2 seasons, and he was a real unlikable character. It was one of the first things Gina Davis ever did. Joanna Cassidy, friend of the show, was in it. She won a Golden Globe for it. It was very, very highly acclaimed critically, but just no one watched it. So then he was in the Slap Maxwell Story. That didn't do very well. And then he did Drexel's Class for a number of years.
Drexel's Class. That's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah. But Dabney Coleman, man. Cloak and Dagger, one of my favorites. It's just like Dabney Coleman. He's never not great in everything he's in. Thursday, what'd you do?
So Thursday, I mean, I totally did the Cosby block. I did the Cosby in Different World block.
I can't blame you.
I did. I mean, I recently rewatched some episodes, and I don't know. I still, because I thought, like, this dude's obviously like a monster, like in real life. Like, if you look,
of course,
if you look at all the shit that he's done, because he's done it, like, he's a creep. But like, we've seen it with our musicians over time, and like these people that you maybe not idolize, but music that you've liked, or movies that you've liked, or TV shows. So I was talking to somebody, I'm like, I'm going to throw on some episodes of The Cosby Show, and I just want to see, like, does the present day just shit from Bill Cosby, like, tank this show? Like, is it weird now? And I put it on, and I still was like, this is bizarre, but it's still kind of funny, but I don't know. It's very weird when things like that happen, I think. Like, you know?
Well, it's the show's not just him. It had this amazing ensemble cast, and the behind the scenes people were really great. And it's a sweet, funny show. And like, especially when he's not on camera, like the scenes with the rest of the cast are great. there's definitely some creepy things in hindsight, like, oh, he's an OBGYN who works from home, which is really creepy. You know, but the show is good. It still holds up. And that's like one of the bigger shames about him being such an awful monster is like all these other people who did great work in that show, it gets kind of buried. Lisa Bonet is great in that. Different World is a fantastic show. This show Probe is also on that night, which I don't remember, Probe. But first of all, don't call a show Probe. Like, that's That's
is it a doctor? Is
show.
It a doctor show?
No, it's like a like an X-Filesy type Ooh. Show. So this one, it says a witch casts a killer spell on a caustic talk show host, but Austin, played by Parker Stevenson, who starred in the show, dismissing witchcraft as a form of hypnosis, suspects there's more than the power of suggestion in her sorcery. And then it says three people drink from the same cup of tainted soup. Only one dies. How can it be murder?
Oh, man.
So he was like a debunker, like he debunked like supernatural yeah. things.
Okay.
Probe. What Terrible. An awful name. And because we're in March, like there's a lot of St. Patrick's Day programming on, speaking of corned beef hash. And Channel 5 is showing my second least favorite Disney film, Darby O'Gill and the Little People.
I've never seen it.
It's only second to the Gnome Mobile. As a terrible Disney movie, I think.
Oof. Yeah.
Oh, the Gnome Mobile.
The Gnome Mobile.
Yeah. If you see, have you seen that?
No.
Don't. But if you do by accident, the theme song will be stuck in your head until the second you die.
Oh, no. Thank you, though. Thank you for the warning.
You're welcome. Yeah, avoid that. Cheers is on that night. It's a rerun. So, you know, maybe I would watch that second half hour of Probe.
Yeah.
Probe.
If Cheers was on, I was probably watching the rerun of Cheers, probably.
Yeah.
And then, I guess, to continue the magician theme with David Copperfield, there was Night Court.
Yes.
And, like, the thing about Night Court, after, like, kind of rereading a little bit of about it, like Bull was, like, my favorite character on Night Court. And, like, the fact that he had a bald head was like weird then.
Oh, totally.
But like now, like that look is like normal.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It was, that was one of the reasons they cast him. So he had shaved his head because he was shooting a Charles Band movie called The Dungeonmaster.
Yeah.
And he normally had a full head of hair and everything he was in. And they liked that. So they specifically asked him to continue doing that. And it was a weird thing. It was like a totally, yeah, you had like Mr. Clean, Bull,
yeah,
Kojak. That's about it.
Yeah, it's a good look. I love how like I love how like John Larroquette kept winning Emmys and then he finally had to be like, stop giving me Emmys.
Yeah,
like
he was so good though. He was so good on it.
He was the best. But it's like, I think he only won like four before he was like, stop. I mean, who would do that
four
now?
In a row, though. That's a lot.
Who would do that?
No now? One would do that now. They'd keep taking him.
Yeah.
Yeah, they'd be like, give me two this year.
Yeah, so props to him.
Yeah,
for that, doing that.
I get, when you have one, when you have four, you have one for every year of high school to rub in people's faces at your high school reunion. What more do you need?
Good point. Yeah. So yeah, I did Night Court and I probably didn't do it when I was 11. But as I got older, I definitely found episodes of Laughing on syndication.
Nick at Night.
Huh? Nick at Night.
Yeah, Nick at Night started airing them.
Yeah.
Yeah, on 1988, they started airing them. I just couldn't. It was so 60s. I had like a physical revulsion to it.
I loved all that shit.
Oh, flowers.
I loved all that shit. Same thing with like, I saw Benny Hill was on in a night. My dad used to love Benny Hill. So he always had Benny Hill on, and like, I never got it. Like, I just didn't understand anything about it. Like,
everybody's dad liked Benny Hill. That was part of being a dad.
Benny Hill and Candlepin Bowling. It was just.
Oh, yeah. If somehow you could get Benny Hill doing Candlepin Bowling to Yakety Sax, like, dads would just implode from pleasure. Like, there'd be no one's dad left.
80s dads would just lose their mind. Throw in a Kenny Rogers cassette tape, and it would just be...
Yeah.
It'd be...
Or Hank Williams Jr.'s rowdy friends are coming over to watch Benny Hill and Candlepin Bowling.
Oh.
You'd die right there. It's never going to get better than that.
It was funny.
My
dad had three cassette tapes in his car, right? And one of them was the debut Whitney Houston tape.
Okay.
The next one was Lionel Richie's Dancing on the Ceiling. And the third was Kenny Rogers' Greatest Hits. And one day I said, Dad, can I bring some of my tapes into the car. So I had my little thing of tapes, and it was like I had the Beatles, and I had, you know, Bob Dylan. And I tried to put on Bob Dylan. He took the tape out, and he shakes it, and he goes, you know, Bob Dylan's just the poor man's Kenny Rogers, you know.
I mean, he's right. Did your dad have a beard?
He did the standard mustache.
Okay. Yeah, I was going to say that's a mustache. That's a guy with a mustache's music collection.
Yeah, he did the standard mustache, 80s mustache guy. Yeah.
Yeah, the Magnum PI.
Yeah, he kind of looked like Eric Estrada, but just a little more white.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Is that how you would describe him to the police if you had to?
Yeah, exactly. To the highway, California Highway Patrol.
So Friday night, what'd you do?
Friday night, I was, of course, Perfect Strangers. I was all about it. All about it, the whole run. Looking back on it, the fact that the whole show was essentially just centered around the fact that he was like foreign. Like,
yeah, it's Borat.
Yeah. But like, that's the whole show. Like, that's the gimmick.
Yeah.
It's just he's foreign and he talks with a weird accent.
Well, don't underestimate the concept of Cousin Larry Appleton just being a selfish fucking dickhead.
Oh, he's a dick.
Because that's also the concept of that show.
It's true. It's true. Yeah, everything about it. I rewatched the first episode the other day when he comes to his door and explains, like, he's going to live with him now. It's so wild.
If you had someone who came to you and said they were your cousin from some weird island, would you let them live with you?
Yeah. Fuck yeah.
Really?
Why not? Right? Just because I love Perfect Strangers so much, I would just be in that headspace.
Yeah. I wonder if there were guys who tried to capitalize on the popularity of Perfect Strangers by pulling that scam.
Oh, yeah. That's a scam to run, I think.
I think so, too. Yeah. You could have cleaned up in the 80s doing that scam.
Yeah. Yeah. When he was in Beverly Hills Cop, was that before that or after that?
That was after that.
It was after.
It was before. So he was in, the first movie he was in is Risky Business.
Okay.
And then he did Beverly Hills Cop, I think around the same time as Perfect Strangers started.
Yeah.
But he was always doing kind of like foreign voice. That was like his thing.
No, I love that. That one scene in Beverly Hills Cop gets me every time. So
Beauty and the Beast is on that night, a show people forget about now, but was massive.
Was it really?
Massive hit. Ron Perlman plays the Beast. Linda Hamilton was the Beauty. And it was huge. It was huge because women loved it. And there wasn't really primetime television for like aimed at women. And it sort of tapped into that same audience that later embraced stuff like Buffy the Vampire Slayer and X-Files and that sort of, and Twilight and all that stuff. But it kind of stumbled into that thing. And this particular episode is worth mentioning because it has a very special guest star. Speaking of your love of guest stars in live action.
Oh, yeah.
Playing the character Eric is, and billed this way, is Big John Studd.
Ooh. So is he in character?
I mean, he's billed as Big John Studd as Eric. So whatever Big John Studd's real name is him in his wrestling persona playing the character of Eric. Now, just out of curiosity, I want to look up Big John Studd's real
name. Yeah, it's not that.
Because you... It'd be funny if it was that, like if it was Big Jonathan Studd.
Jonathan M. Studd.
Big John Studd's real name... is, oh, all right, you want to guess?
Is John his first name?
First name's John.
Is it something like Smith?
It's John William Minton.
Minton. I like Stud better.
Stud is better. Everyone knows Minton is Old English for stud.
But when you were saying about like shows
Big
for
John
women,
Stud.
Shows for women and stuff, like, wasn't it weird that like even like Who's the Boss, Golden Girls, like, is that where like the horny older lady kind of started making an appearance? Was that kind of right around then?
Yeah, that was when it started being kind of okay, like for middle-aged and older women to be like the sex pot, you know?
Yeah.
And it got it was still played for laughs, but it was like weirdly normalized in those shows.
Yeah.
Where you were allowed to be an older lady and not be a grandma.
Yeah.
Like a, you know, like the woman who owned Tweety and Looney Tunes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like any woman over 50 was that lady for a long time. The show Highwaymen is on as well, which was a very short lived show. And it starred Sam Jones, who was Flash Gordon,
yep,
who's been on the show. Mm-hmm. And it was this action show with him and Australian rugby player Jocko, who did the Energizer ads. And they played bounty hunters. And this is an old buddy falsely convicted of stealing an armored car calls on the highwayman to break him out of a Mexican prison and help locate the man who framed him.
Wow.
I mean, I'm in that. Like, how could you not watch that?
Yeah. As a kid, I don't think I would have been on it, but I'd take it for a spin now. It was same thing, like, to skip back a few days, there was that show Wise Guy.
Oh, yeah.
And it's the dude from Breaking Bad.
Yeah. First thing he ever did.
I was like, I think I'd put that on now.
It's great. Yeah. Jonathan Banks. Yeah. He's great in it. Actually, Melanie Chartoff, who's a friend of the show, is Miss Musso on Parker Lewis.
Oh, yeah.
She has like a 10 episode arc where she plays Jonathan Banks is like love interest. Whoa. On Wise Guy. And yeah, Wise Guy is actually really
good. I didn't
good.
Even know it existed. I Googled it. I was like, what is this? This is another cop, weird cop show. And like his face came up and I was like, no shit. Wow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And he's great in it. Yeah, I really like Wise Guy. And then what is on at 9:30?
So I did like Full House, Mr. Belvedere, like that block.
You're staying on ABC. That's a good night. That's a good pick to stay there. Just had Rob Stone on the show, plays Kevin. This is a Kevin-centric episode. Kevin decides to quit monkeying around and chooses a college major, medicine. But when he announces his plans to be a nurse and not a doctor, his parents go ape.
Oh,
I remember this one.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Euchre's like a nurse, Kev, which now like you, that would not fly. Like there are so many men who are like, I'm a nurse practitioner. I'm a nurse. People are like, okay.
Yeah.
Why would that ever be a problem? But apparently it was.
Yeah. Cause he did, he did Major League after that, Euchre.
Yeah. I think the first Major League was,
did he do anything before this? Or he just decided to be an actor.
So he was a professional baseball player. And then he became famous because he did the color commentary and everybody loved it. And then really the thing that broke him nationally was, I think, of Miller Lite.
Oh, ads. Yeah, they yeah.
I think it was Miller Lite. It was a beer company.
It was beer, yeah.
So everybody knew him for that. And then he would do a lot of talk shows. He was like one of those guys that was just always on the talk shows. So they signed him to do a sitcom.
Wow.
Because that's what you did then. And I want to mention what was on this episode of 2020, because 2020 famously is the only show my parents didn't allow me to watch. And it says, scheduled, a report on whether Americans are worrying excessively about developing cancer, despite the fact that, quote, we're healthier than we've been in history.
Oh, no.
That's a weird episode. Like, stop complaining about all the cancer, you babies.
Bunch of babies.
Oh, we're healthier than ever. Cures with the cancer. So that is the week. But as you know, TV Guide, it is not just informative. It has opinions and it cheers and it jeers. And I would like to read you the cheers and jeers of this week, March 12th to the 18th, 1988, and see if you agree or disagree with these. We have, this is a really jeer heavy week. We got three jeers and only one cheer. So I'm going to save the cheer for last.
All right.
Jeers to NBC's Matlock for cheating on what originally sounded like a novel TV concept. At the end of a recent episode, defense attorney Ben Matlock, played by Andy Griffith, I don't think I knew his first name was Ben, was to reveal the identity of a killer. During the show, viewers were asked to vote by phone for one of three suspects. Having the plot determined by popular consensus is a fine idea, except that the ending and dialogue in the original script were exactly the same. They just filmed Griffith reading three different names and inserted the appropriate claw. What the hell else would they do?
I know. Like, I don't understand why they're so bummed.
Like, they want them to retroactively go back and change the episode based on who people voted was the killer? I don't even understand.
Yeah, the dude just sounds like a wet blanket just trying to throw you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He's trying to mellow Matlock's buzz.
Yeah, absolutely.
Jeers to public television's decision to cut William F. Buckley's firing line back to half an hour per week. Programmers argue that a shorter show is more convenient for them to schedule, but public broadcasting isn't supposed to be about convenience. It's supposed to be about excellence.
Well, he's just an upset guy.
This is some serious old man anger.
He's just upset.
Although this jeer, this may be my favorite jeer of all time. At least my favorite jeer I've had on the show in 2022.
All right.
The final jeer of the week. Jeers to Fox Broadcasting for killing off Chuck Connors' character on Werewolf. Playing the head of a werewolf family with ferocious glee, Connors was the best part of an otherwise silly program. Insiders say that Fox wanted the show's heavy to be a younger man, so Connors was given the silver bullet. Blame the loss on TV's obsession with pulling in a younger audience. Who's mad that they killed Chuck Connors on Werewolf?
I mean, I feel like...
I loved Werewolf and I didn't even give a shit about that.
I was going to say that. I feel like even back then, that wasn't a hot take. Like, people didn't care.
I think it's just because this guy's clearly old.
Yeah.
And he's mad that they killed the old guy.
Well, that could be it.
And finally, cheers. The only cheer of the week. Cheers to NBC's Alf for becoming more entertaining and inventive. Most of the last season, the unsightly, irreverent alien was getting used to the conventions and conveniences of American family life. This season, the show has found its comic voice, with Alf poking fun at politics, television, and other subjects. Alf, pictured right. That's my favorite part. Like, you need to tell us, this one page is Andy Griffith and Alf. They're the only two people on this page. And you need to tell us that's Alf? Like, no shit, it's Alf. Alf, pictured right, has developed into our funniest visitor from space, even if sometimes it's hard to tell if he's from beyond the Milky Way or below the borscht belt.
No.
So that's just like a, hey, I like that. I love that Alf.
He does love Alf. Do you think, like, the Alf guy, because he's still alive, right?
Paul Fusco, yeah.
So, like, I mean, of course, like, all the Ted movies got huge, right?
Yep.
Ted the Bear, and like, that's essential. I mean, I'm not gonna say it's the same thing, but it's definitely a take on it.
It's Alfish, yeah. But he's tried to do a bunch of Alf reboots, and he's very particular about like what he wants.
Really?
Have you ever seen the Alf outtakes on YouTube?
No.
Oh my god, it's him in character as Alf between takes just saying like horrifically racist things.
Oh no.
It's worth a watch.
Maybe that's why there's not a reboot.
Well, they've tried a few times. He had that talk show on TV Land for a while, and then they had the Project Alf movie, and then every couple years he like threatens to bring back Alf, but I don't, it's not gonna work now.
No,
like, Alf's not gonna work.
No.
you can't do Alf in 2022. Like, there's not even like a dark take you could do on Alf, like a reimagining of it. Like, it's just not going to work.
I mean,
they
could do what they did with like Fresh Prince. Have you seen the new Fresh Prince?
No.
You haven't?
No, I didn't like the original that much.
Oh, watch the new one though. Like,
it's good.
It's on the Peacock network, and like, Carlton's like doing coke. Like, Jeffrey, the butler guy, is like a mobster.
Jeez.
It's like Will had to move with his aunt and uncle because he got into a gang fight with a gun.
Oh, so they went heavy on this.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I was hooked. I watched the whole thing.
So you want an Alf reboot where, like, Alf is played by Jonathan Banks?
I mean, you could make him played by, like, the dude from, like, Lord of the Rings. What's his name? Little guy there. Or am I thinking of the other...
You're thinking of Peter Dinklage.
Tits and Dragons from, show. Like, I don't watch any of that stuff, so I don't know.
Yeah.
Peter Dinklage.
You're thinking of Peter Dinklage, yeah, from Game of Thrones. You want Peter Dinklage to play a dark reboot of Alf is what you've just said to me.
Well, yeah. I think it'd be great.
I mean, we can ask him. He might be into it.
I mean, he's a pretty accomplished actor, so I don't know how well that would go, but...
Are you saying Alf's beneath him?
Yeah. Yeah,
you're probably right.
I think so. I mean, without Willie, what are you going to do? What are you going to do?
No. Yeah. You can't really do anything. They do a reboot where instead of staying for alien life form, it stands for something else. And you like find out in the last episode, it's like a big twist, you know, like Chud.
Oh yeah. I'm sure it's all been thought out. I'm surprised that guy just doesn't do like the convention circuit. Like
he's thinks very highly of himself.
Oh, cause he'd make money doing that, you know?
Yeah. But he sees himself as the, heir to Jim Henson's throne.
Oh.
And so, yeah, he's not doing that.
Yeah. That's a stretch.
Oh yeah. And it always was a stretch, but before Alf, he did a series of holiday specials with puppets. He did a Christmas special called Santa's Magic Toy Bag. He did a Halloween special and they're real bad. They're real bad. and you're like, you're not Jim Henson. No one else is Jim Henson.
Yeah. Well, like, we always have Elf.
We only have one. We'll always have Elf until Peter Dinklage becomes Elf and takes it and ruins our childhood.
Yes. Yep.
We'll set. How about this? Peter Dinklage stars as Elf. We set it in Worcester. And he lands in the TableTalk Pie Company's offices. And he has to take over when Mary Tonnacocaine dies.
Mary Tonnacocaine. I'm going to look that up when we're done.
Look it up. Look it up. And when you stop laughing in 3 days, tell me how funny it was.
It's so terrible.
Oh, I love it. All right. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I'm glad we had a chance to finally do it.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. It was awesome.
There you go. That is Mike Kane pictured right, not Alf. You know, Baby Jessica doesn't come up enough. So if you know Baby Jessica and you think she would do this show, why don't you email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or kenatiicanread.com. I would love to speak with her. It's never going to happen, but, you know, who knows? I don't know. Maybe Baby Jessica's a listener of this show. She may be a big fan. I don't know unless I ask, so. Baby Jessica, adult Baby Jessica, if you are out there, send me that email. Or, you know, maybe be a patron. Go to patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. You can give me as little as $1 a month. It is a huge help. Honestly, oof, I could not do this show without you guys who give to the Patreon and more than you know. So thank you guys for doing that. And, you know, thank you guys also for just listening. I you're very loyal listeners, and I very much appreciate it. So anyway, speaking of things I appreciate you and you being here next week for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
I fell in the well. I was in the well.